Hello, my name is Artur Rahimov, and in this video I'm going to talk about one kind of historical topic about who were behind death of Dr. Buteyko, who tried to kill him, because we know from different sources, from autobiography of Dr. Buteyko, Buteyko trilogy, from interviews with Dr. Buteyko as well, public interviews done for like radios, for newspapers, they were published, some of them already translated on normalbriefing.org. And who were behind this death and behind many other kind of weird, strange events which took place with this treatment, this therapy or the Buteyko method, even like long ago, because what happens with Dr. Buteyko, like first maybe I can explain how his death took place. In 1998, he visited Novosibirsk, because at this time he already lived in Moscow. And to open Buteyko clinic, he was invited to Novosibirsk, and he had an apartment in Novosibirsk. So during this time, during one of the evenings, he was coming back to his apartment, and he was chased like three men with metal tubes, kind of chased him, and they beat him heavily like with these metal tubes, and he was left in the snow lying like bleeding and unconscious. And some girl, like I think was like with a dog walking nearby, noticed him, and we called ambulance, and we took him to the ambulance, and his friends immediately sent him to Moscow, because they somehow also suspected that it's not safe for him to remain in Novosibirsk. So that happens in 1998. He did not die actually from this trauma, but he was never able to overcome the damage produced, because he had bleeding in the brain. And for many years, like even though I guess he tried all the best to practice and to kind of to eliminate damage which was created by this accident, by this incident, and he could not. And what happens in 2003, his health dramatically deteriorated, and so I met Lyudmila Buteyko 2 years later after his death in 2005, when she came to, we had like small conference in the Netherlands in Utrecht, and I was kind of helping to Andrei Novozhilov and Lyudmila Buteyko to translate them and a bunch of practitioners, mostly from Europe. And she told me actually there, like when we were three of us were walking together, like Andrei, Lyudmila and me, and Lyudmila told me to me that I told him not to go to Novosibirsk, don't go, but he did not listen. He was very obstinate. It was known, of course, Dr. Buteyko in a way was a very obstinate man. And so Lyudmila, of course, was of course extremely upset that he did not listen to her. And but later I also met Peter Kolb, and it was also like I think somewhere around 2006-2007, when Peter Kolb actually was the only person who kind of got immediate news that Buteyko was very, very sick in 2003, just days before his death. And he was actually the only Western person who came specifically to Moscow in order just to be next to him, because he knew that his health was extremely bad. So Peter Kolb actually flew from Australia to Moscow. You can imagine, of course, like how big his passion and commitment was to Dr. Buteyko and to his teaching. And Peter Kolb told me that was like again just a few years later after Dr. Buteyko death, that actually looked like he had some kind of tropical disease, because his skin was covered with something very strange, something weird, like something really bad took place with his skin. And I don't know exactly what happened, like, and I know relatives often reluctant to talk about these events, because I'm going to analyze like this as well, like this factor, psychological factor related to unwillingness of relatives. And I know it's extremely common, like worldwide, when something can happen with somebody and some other like people trying to get information what exactly took place, kind of relatives don't tell, and we try to maybe even hide some information, because we see it's kind of damaging maybe to the image, to the reputation of this person. But sometimes it can be actually opposite, and I believe that in this case it's also probably the situation when this type of information can be crucial in order to find the perpetrators, those who organized these events. Now, how we can organize the find the perpetrators? I believe it would be actually very useful to look at certain facts which are known from history of Buteyko movement and what took place even like as long as 3 decades, like 30 years exactly in 1968, before this kind of tragic event, beating of Dr. Buteyko in 1998. So what took place in 1968? Well, we know from, again, various numerous sources, like from his interviews, and you can read also on some official sites, like Buteyko Clinic website, for example, in Moscow and others, that in 1968 there was a medical, first medical approbation of the Buteyko method, because like one academician from the like Ministry of Health, academician Mishalkin, he promised that if we only cure 80% of severe asthmatics, they were going immediately to accept this method as one of the official techniques to use to treat asthma. So, and in order to test the method, we organized a clinical trial, our approbation, in 1968 in St. Petersburg, or Leningrad, it used to be in the second largest city in Russia. And one of the like well-trained doctors, trained again by Dr. Buteyko, she came to St. Petersburg and she like got 46 people with severe asthma. Like, we deliberately asked actually people who had severe asthma. And she managed to kind of cure virtually all of them except two. And to get better some months later, because like just took a bit longer time for them. So what happens, like results were really amazing. It's like kind of almost 95% success rate, very, very high. And so Dr. Buteyko and of course people who were next to him were very excited about this great result. And what we did, created and signed two letters. One was sent to Moscow, and one we sent to themselves, to Novosibirsk. Probably, I don't know exactly, probably it took place when they were in Novosibirsk. And so, the next thing was quite interesting or unusual, because both these letters actually disappeared. So the letter that was sent to Moscow, to Ministry of Health, like results, kind of conclusions, and the letter which was sent to themselves, the copy, also disappeared. Now, instead of that, that's another kind of curious fact, which maybe we can again think about, that somebody made a phone call, and it was falsified phone call, as Dr. Buteyko, you can read again in his interviews, saying that actually out of 46 people, only two improved. So we kind of reversed the results, like with kind of artistic trick, imagine, like, so 46 were given, 46, so we felt two were not cured, and we get like improved better, but those who falsify the result, we reverse it completely. That's actually, there is, I believe, one special group of people who are kind of famous in this kind of artistic creativity, you know, like, and we inverse it to exact opposite one it should be. So who could it be? I'm going to kind of later add some more events pointing out in the same direction, but let us think logically about the situation. Okay, you take a letter, you wrote a letter, and like doctor signed it, doctors from the Institute of Pulmonology in St. Petersburg or Leningrad, we also signed the letter, so we made like two copies, we put these envelopes, letters, and probably we brought it to the postal office, or maybe we left some in the like in the mailbox. Okay. Now, who can intercept this letter? That's, I believe, an important question here. And Russian sources generally say like that all these problems were created by some medical mafia. So this is how they called it. I read it again in different Russian kind of sources, Soviet sources, online books, and so on. And now we can think about, okay, so these are letters, like we go to postal office, to central postal office, and we travel to the Moscow central office. Which medical mafia has access to this postal office? Let's say like somebody who is president of some like big pharma company or producing drugs. He would go to the postal office, yeah, and say like, oh, this is a letter from Buteyko. I don't like it. Let me take it out. Do you think it's like a realistic scenario, or does it like sound kind of not so normal? Or maybe it was Minister of Health himself. Or like somebody would come and say, I'm from Ministry of Health, or from the Minister of Health. And would this person get access, like he would say, I'm an assistant or a secretary of the Minister of Health, so some like executive kind of person to take these letters, to maybe take it away from you, to so you have to give these letters to me. Would it work out or not in the postal office? What do you think? Soviet Russia in a way worked the same like as Western countries in 60s, and postal offices, I guess, did not change much for many, many decades already, and now probably situation is similar. So who else could it be? Would it also does not make sense, like why a postal office would listen to some, like even Minister of Health? Or maybe it was, probably people on the West may knew about him already. So maybe it was like some Western big pharma, you know, people saying, well, I'm like, we are billionaires, like people who have billions of money, and they would come to the postal office, like, I don't know, maybe in, it could be done in St. Petersburg, in Moscow, also in Novosibirsk. They would come to this central post office, say, we need this letter because we just want to take it away from you. So would it work out? Probably not as well. Okay, let us think about somebody, maybe the richest people in the world, like we say, like we are like control billions and billions, we take like own everything, and like we like can change economies of countries, and they would come say like I'm representative of these super rich people of the world, like who control like economies, money, currency rates, and everything. Like, so would postal offices, like managers of postal offices in St. Petersburg, in Moscow, in Novosibirsk, would we listen to this group of people? Probably not as well. So then the question is, who can come and take these letters? Well, I thought I live in Canada for 25 years. And since I live in Canada, I experience a world of hundreds of world similar events, which I'm describing now, when letters were stolen. My emails were stolen. My letters were stolen as well. It's from Canada to United States. Some others I have it described in my other videos. But what I know from Canadian legislation, like from laws, from people who know laws, how government function, how different government organizations function, and postal offices, we are part of the government, of course, as well. Even private organization probably would be, could be also subject to the same law, because, for example, in Canada, the law is very simple. Canadian secret agents can come to any place at any time and take any object, can remove, install, or take copy, or whatever you want to do with any object. This is an exact sentence from the law, which is called CSIS Act, the Canadian Security Intelligence Service Act, meaning that like secret agents, organizations, they are able to do that. And of course, if we think about Soviet Russia, who would do it? Well, of course, only agents from KGB could come and steal letters. That's it, could take away letters so there are no traces left. And then the question is, who could create a falsified call, who could like pretend that he's somebody else and call to the Minister of Health, say, oh, results are like total disaster, the Buteyko method like does not work, only two people accidentally like get better, so this method does not work, because this actually phone call, as Dr. Buteyko claimed, became a reason why later his laboratory was closed, like the equipment was taken out like by different like departments, laboratories, so like virtually everything disappeared, people were fired, like personnel, because he had like qualified personnel, several people working with him, and they were not provided even jobs, so we kind of eliminated everything, and for him it was a big shock. So the question, going back to falsified telephone call, who could do it again? Well, that of course should be people who control communication again. This is like phone call, you know, and then phone call is made, like there are people in the middle, you know, of course at the origin and at the destination, who are also online and who record who is calling to him and what type of information is transmitted. And that's like, again, like we can say, oh, that could be like some Illuminati, you know, like some aliens or whatever. I don't think it's kind of does not make sense unless you say, well, this was done by secret agents, and in this case it was from KGB. Now, going further into history of the Buteyko method, we know another like totally kind of astonishing or weird or strange fact. And when these astonishing words, strange facts happen, I believe you need to think, like, after, if you like listen the whole video, you would know now in which direction to think. And what was this fact? Well, the fact was following. There was a second conference of doctors which took place about the Buteyko method. And what happens at this conference, it was early 1990s or late 80s. And so they published a book which is called now also Big Buteyko Book. Why? Because there are many reports of doctors about this application of the Buteyko method. It's called the Buteyko method application in clinical practice. So a very famous book, of course, for practitioners. It's kind of a handbook. Many theoretical articles at the beginning by doctors Buteyko, by Sulyagin, by Samotyosova about diabetes and so on and so on. Plus, in addition to that, the second part is full of different kind of reports of doctors, where doctors share their experiences with application of the method on different health conditions. So they provide actually amazing results in terms of, like, they list exactly how many people, like, with diabetes, with hypertension, with like, let's say, epilepsy, asthma, bronchitis, COPD, like all these conditions they list, and they show exactly how many of them were using the Buteyko briefing technique, how many of them improved, and they say, like, oh, like, insane amounts of money were saved on use of medication, because, like, it was it reduced like 90%, 92%, 95%, very, very large reduction, because the method seems to be, like, amazing, because, like, all different groups of people, they positively respond to retraining of their breath, so they have less symptoms and they require less medication. Amazing results. So, and this is again many, many, many doctors trained by Dr. Buteyko. Now, these were doctors, of course, nearly all of them were trained from areas around, say, Novosibirsk. So, Siberia is a very large area, you can imagine. And they had Krasnoyarsk, Krasnoyarsk region, Omsk, Tomsk, especially these cities. And so, they are very large regions in Siberia. And most of the doctors were actually from these parts, so where Buteyko could probably travel, or maybe they travel to him to learn the method. But what happens later is very interesting, and that kind of another very weird or strange fact, which I have a web page about on the website, where I actually list the names of many, many doctors who first report these amazing results with the method, application of the method, that people are healed, no symptoms, no medication. People, of course, probably also were very happy with their results. And then all of a sudden, like, they all disappear. Like, so we no longer practice the technique. And that took place during 80s and 90s. So, and the question here arises, it's very interesting, like, how we first report that it's excellent method, great results, like, such a huge economy, like 90% drugs less, like, big money are saved. And then, like, some years later, there is no sign that we actually teach this method any longer. So there was some kind of force, you know, that made these doctors to stop using this technique. And then I started to research more, and I found another kind of interesting relationship that, actually, Dr. Buteyko also trained some other doctors, and they were from other parts of Russia. And some of them even later moved to, for example, Dr. Natalia Lapo was in Siberia, and then he moved to the UK in 1990s, and he's still teaching the method even now, like 2010, probably 2020, she's likely still teaching, because she was a great teacher for children. The Buteyko method for children. She wrote such an amazing article about application of the Buteyko method for children as well. So, but all Siberian doctors, like, non-practice, I started to search and look, like, even online, and I found actually many of them. Of course, I did not mention another very important detail, because these were actually high-ranking doctors. It's not just ordinary, you know, like family physician or GP, general practitioner. These were doctors who were, some of them were directors or chief medical doctors of hospitals, of clinics. So, the chief endocrinologist, doctor, like, who is responsible for all hormonal problems of the Krasnoyarsk region. She was also a Buteyko doctor, trained by Buteyko, and she also had amazing article. You can read it again in this book. So, all Siberian doctors all of a sudden, like, stopped practicing the method. But only in Siberia, because you look outside, Moscow, other places, Ukraine and so on, because Dr. Buteyko trained doctors there. We are still practicing the method. Those who moved abroad, some doctors as well, also teach the method. So it looks like really strange what was going on in Siberia. And but Dr. Buteyko, again, like when Dr. Lyudmila Buteyko was telling me, okay, I told him, I begged him not to go to Novosibirsk because it's not good to go, like not probably not safe place. What she implied, this is what she told me, like privately, just before his death, and he did not listen. And like, okay, she was in Moscow at this time, and Dr. Buteyko was in Moscow. So somehow we were safe in Moscow. But Dr. when he came to Novosibirsk, when this event took place. And friends, we knew that actually Novosibirsk, not so good place, we put him in plane, so he flew as soon as possible back because of this kind of event. So that kind of, again, like we start to think, okay, what was going on like with Siberia here? And here, somebody who does not know the work of past, but I would say probably even modern national security organization, we would be quite surprised. But since I had more than 20 years of experience with national security agents and with all type of activities, how we deal with targets like people whom we kind of watch, monitor, who we want to change, I know that we can do literally like thousands of things, which kind of by law, hard to say, like if these are legal things or not. For example, of course, beating Dr. Buteyko is just a criminal thing. So, because in my view, that was against done by secret agents, because these were the people who would know where is his apartment, where he would come back, and so on. Not some big pharma, medical mafia, or so on. Because these are like people who kind of we don't know communication. We are not in communication, and if we try to organize something like this. Well, you see, like, when all communication is controlled by certain organization, of course, this organization has key to all this information. And it's known worldwide that generally security organizations are created to, as they call it in many countries, to collect information. So, but when we collect information, and like another interesting thing happened. Okay, we collect information, what do we do with that? That's kind of question. Which explains like why Dr. Buteyko discovery got attention from national security agents. And maybe I finish part with Siberia. So my explanation is relatively simple. Siberia was the place, if somebody knows history, that of Gulag labor camps. And somewhere in 1930s, especially 35, 36, 37 seems to be was the worst year, where millions of people were basically killed. Well, they were put in conditions in these labor camps, where their health got so poor because of like this horrible kind of living conditions, very poor food in somewhere in Siberia, and very harsh treatment, extremely stressful psychologically. You can lead Archipelago Gulag by Solzhenitsyn, who got a Nobel Prize for that. And what happened there, like they would release people before they die, you know, and they would try to get, let's say, back to like main part of Russia, because usually they were like from some European part of Russia, not from Siberia originally. And they would not make it, you know, they would die on the way, like maybe 1, 2, 3 days later in a train somewhere there. And that, so in total, like historians believe, probably somewhere around like 20 million people died. Like it's of course insanely large number, and mostly of course it's known Gulag labor camps were created mostly in Siberia. And of course to run this machinery, to run all these Gulag labor camps, it was through the work of KGB agents. KGB agents, now it's FSB, like we changed the name with Vladimir Putin and so on. But my explanation is actually it was KGB agent later in the 80s, 90s who were not happy with Buteyko doctors and who were using thousands of techniques, you know. People start to use Buteyko method and they can start like also poisoning him with some or create like some other kind of word events and so on. Thousands of methods we know how to derail or demolish like certain movement. And I believe that actually Buteyko doctors in Siberia who were persecuted for their work in 80s and 90s, were secretly and persecuted by KGB agents. Why secretly? Well, because nobody described it. There is no so-called, I don't know, investigative journalism. I think now it's 2020. I believe it's dead already, even on the West, not talking about Russia. And therefore, it's a kind of event. At the same time, I believe is important to understand as part of our history. But another kind of important detail which I want to add here is that, again, Dr. Buteyko was actually relatively safe in Moscow. He had an apartment, and Lyudmila Buteyko, he actually had three divorces, three wives before her. So we lived quite okay, actually, together. Not only that, we know that Lyudmila Buteyko was actually a very active friend and proponent and promoter of the Buteyko method. She like, became a practitioner and, of course, extremely enthusiastic in supporting Dr. Buteyko in this area, like promotion of the Buteyko method and teaching and so on, teaching like hundreds, maybe thousands of patients. Now, in Siberia, we know that actually situation was different because talking about personal life, like another kind of aspect of Dr. Buteyko life, he had three divorces. And we know that looks like none of his wives, which he divorced, actually learned the method. That looks like a bit strange as well. Like you see, like in Siberia, so he married three times and he had divorces three times. Okay, then in Moscow he got Lyudmila, and like until her death, she was next to him. Like that was many, many years. That's kind of hard to understand, but in order to explain that, the kind of explanation that I have in mind, that I believe that actually security agencies, not only in Russia, but even these days, and even in the Western world, be it like United States or whatever, Germany, Italy, Spain, England, Australia, like again, Western country, I believe that secret agents actually may have, often have interests in order to either create certain families, like certain kind of relationships, or destroy them. So we actively actually engage in this type of activity. And this is again something which you never hear in public radio, TVs, like you would not find such information there. But this is part of the work. And in my view, this is kind of additional fact that Dr. Buteyko had three divorces, okay, which I believe could be influenced or kind of instigated or kind of promote like with influence of KGB agents. Whereas again in Moscow until his life, Lyudmila Buteyko was really faithful wife and servant for faithful partner for Dr. Buteyko. So because my explanation is actually all these problems that Dr. Buteyko had, again we already spoke about. Well, we started with his death, of course, beating in Novosibirsk, not in Moscow. So he came just to Novosibirsk for a few days to open his Buteyko clinic. Now we talk about falsification of letters, which took place probably much earlier. And at this time, it's possible that KGB in Moscow and St. Petersburg also would not be happy with kind of Buteyko method becoming more publicly known. I'll talk about a bit later because I want to explain like kind of few more details here to make kind of a coherent, a clear picture, like so that you can understand all these facts, events together. Now, then we were talking about persecution of doctors only in Siberia. Dr. Buteyko having three marriages, three divorces only in Siberia, meaning that again, actually, it looks like later, starting from 80s, 90s, and later, Moscow were kind of not so against Dr. Buteyko, and in Siberia they still were persecuting and again like kind of organized this 1998 beating of Dr. Buteyko. Now, so my understanding here is, and I know that this is true even for Western services, that actually national security organizations around the world probably as well. And in some countries, maybe it's not kind of as big difference, function as separate units. What does it mean? Like if we take any Western country, it has probably areas, regions, or states, you know, like whatever, like how it's called, provinces, like in Canada, we are called in the United States, we are states, like 50 states. And sometimes a state, I know, like for example, in California, we would have four different FBI kind of headquarters for four different areas. Some of them it's exactly the state, so it's all different. And what happens here, I believe, that actually all these units we function independently, meaning that we are able to take their own decisions. For example, like if there is something like Dr. Buteyko, I know many other people as well who experience the influence as well of secret agents, that the life of a particular targeted person like Dr. Buteyko, or maybe later was Alexander Stalmatsky, for example, later could be some other people, they would be, their life would be dependent on what particular area of the country we are in. And this is really hard to understand because, like, all my life, I thought that it's actually, if it's national security organization, should be just one organization which has a chronic, like, it has a coherent or the same policy in relation to the same person if this person travels from one place to another. And after my, again, like more than 20 years of experience of living like in, I don't know, 50 or 70 or 100 places around the world, I can certainly say that this is not the case. This is not the case for, again, for United States, for Canada, for England, for Germany, and many, many other countries and places, because we have a lot of flexibility. And for me, it looks like totally weird or strange fact because, let's say, if I have an account in the Bank of America, I can go to the Bank of America in Florida, for example, as I did like in Miami or in New York City or, let's say, in Seattle or in Portland or in Los Angeles. And my account has the same amount of money because I'm the same person. So, but with secret agents, this is not the case. It's like they decide on their own. And for example, in some places, again, they can organize his divorces. And in some places, they can be like kind of not interested in his personal life. So let's put it this way. So therefore, I believe that actually it was Siberian KGB who organized all these problems. At the same time, I'm happy to say that actually I know that there are some former Buteyko doctors who again reported in this like big Buteyko book, late 80s, early 90s, then they disappeared because we did not teach the Buteyko method. There are no signs that we were teaching the Buteyko method for many years. But later we reappeared again because I believe now this Siberian kind of organization is somehow was changed. Why it was changed? Well, it's kind of, again, we need to go a bit in history and see what was going on with Gulag labor camps. And when Joseph Stalin died and he organized like all this machinery and he had like Lavrentiy Beria, he's one of his like kind of KGB leaders who was behind actually these millions of murders with, of course, kind of spiritual participation of Stalin. And after death of Stalin, there were definitely big changes in Moscow. So very different people and so on took power in KGB, took power with like his ministry. So there are big changes took place in the Communist Party as well. And later we know it was Khrushchev time and Brezhnev time and so on. But in Siberia, actually, again, since KGB in the past has been as large separate independent units, okay, Moscow changed after death of Stalin. But what happened in Siberia? What, who would change people in Siberia? You need to kind of completely to kind of dissolve, disorganize like previous people who were, of course, like if it was KGB people, of course we were in very good relationship or even having control of police, army, you know, all communication services, including, because I was talking about postal service or phone lines, you know, to make a falsified telephone call saying that Buteyko method was a total failure during this first clinical trial, like totally invert the information, like saying that it's actually 5% of people only improved. In reality, it's 95% of people improved. So that's again, of course, KGB people. So we have like total control. We know nobody can see them, but we can see everybody, what we are doing in their particular area. And that also kind of provides us another piece of information related to why we were interested in the Buteyko method. That's another kind of very important, like why KGB people would be interested in health. Like, looks maybe a bit strange. In order to understand that part, we now need to think even like, let's say, about modern times. If you're a kind of person who got this fact, this news, I don't know, maybe you never heard about it. But it is known now, so it's a fact, that touch screen devices like computers, cell phones, and so on, tablets, iPads, such devices were actually already used starting from the 1990s by two types of organizations, by military and by secret agents, of course. So what happened here is, then of course, obviously, like somebody invented this kind of technological thing, touchscreen devices, you know, that, like, because they look nice and only somebody comes and nobody seen it, you can move screen, you know, it like magnify, you can, and you can kind of move page from page, like by moving your finger. Look, you're like a god almost, you know, like you move, like if nobody's seen it before. If, like, for somebody who is like totally new to this technology. And so therefore, like, okay, but people got it like, what, like 15 or 20 years later? Like, okay, so for 15, 20 years, like all these touchscreen devices were not known. That's okay. So what happened then? Well, obviously what happened, somebody created this like quite interesting technological invention. And so secret agents, of course, they were like watching, you know, like looking for the laboratory, for people, like all these patents and innovations. And we, oh gosh, that's a new thing. No, nobody can do it. No, if, and so like, okay, if they kept it hidden, like for, let's say, 15 or 20 years. And this is just like kind of like technological kind of rubbish in a way. Like if you think about like killings, spiritual life, like health of millions of people. It's like in a way like, oh, okay, technological rubbish was hidden for 15, 20 years. Okay, that was about technological rubbish. Somebody made a decision probably, yeah? Like, okay, we want to hide it for 15, 20 years and give it only to military and secret agents. That's quite kind of interesting idea if you think about it, yeah? Somebody invented it. And what did they do with inventor? Like another interesting question. Because usually when you invent something, you can get a patent, and patent is valid only for 20 years. So it's quite a tricky thing, because it's possible that the inventor may not get like virtually any money like for that, like for this like kind of technologically, it's a huge thing. And it could be millions, billions, I don't know, because it's if all around the world, like billions of people started to use it, that's of course like kind of probably a really big thing. But when secret agent stole it, what he probably it was a guy like gadgets, you know, usually done by males. What he got from it, maybe nothing, I don't know. But in any case, like, so we have this gadget, like, which was kind of hidden by secret agents. We kind of decided that people should not use it yet. We are going to use it. It's like, as I told, like, you know, like you need to be like a god, you know, like you come and like moving fingers and like it's moving, like, you know, screen, like magnify, like magic, you know, like a magician. So okay, that's about a gadget. But then okay, what about a discovery? Because Dr. Buteyko discovered the cause of death, how to recover from nearly any chronic disease by retraining your breath, by changing your breath. So he kind of made a bunch of discoveries. We discussed like discoveries of Dr. Buteyko, table of health zones right here, and his method as well, plus he had several other patent applications as well. What would happen in this case, like if a gadget was hidden for 15, 20 years, and it's again a fact, what would happen with the technique, like let's say in the eyes of KGB agents, so KGB agents, okay, so this guy actually is saying, and he's like actually showing, and we are like watching him already in all 60s, because this is what agents for. You know, they watch who is doing what. And so we see that Dr. Buteyko actually invented the technique, and this technique works really well, but so far like nobody knows about that. Aha. So okay, then Dr. Buteyko, okay, we say, go to St. Petersburg, Leningrad, and do this probation, show us that it actually works, we are going to give you 46 severely sick asthmatics. So let's see how you can fix them, like outside Siberia, like so there is no kind of less magic, you know, like not Siberia, somewhere in St. Petersburg, like near Finland. So we go and they fix the people, and okay, KGB people, KGB people, agents and think, okay, now, so we have this like astonishing results of the trial, approbation, like mini clinical trial. And now we are going to send it to Moscow. Huh, gosh, then of course, like, gosh, in Moscow, like, kind of the health people, like they would not probably be, He would be probably interested, I don't know, maybe even to kind of to put it like for public use, you know, that we may start train more doctors and put it like in central radio, TV, newspapers and so on. Like, that's kind of probably we did not like it. That's my explanation, you know, like. And I thought actually in another way also, this is kind of a relatively mild explanation. The more kind of possible, also another possible explanation is following. When KGB agents, and I know Western agents around the world, we have kind of similar ideas these days, they view the area as something that all belongs to them. Like people, police, you know, lawyers, if there are any parliaments or like any administration, it all belongs to them because they can make a phone call and people can do anything for them. I know, like situations, for example, somebody, some FBI agent can make a phone call to some police department, for example. And in 5 minutes, we would line up, like, 50 police officers, if we want to. Or we can say, like, take 10 police cruisers, put sirens on them, and go to this area, and we show, like, which route to go. Or we say to them, go there and wait. Or like until some person maybe shows up and then you turn sirens on. Like we know how to control fire departments, paramedics. We also can organize these things with them. So therefore, like going back to Buteyko discovery and how secret agents may view it from KGB, they actually viewed it, it was not Dr. Buteyko who discovered it. Because it already belonged to them. You know, it discovered on the area and it automatically belongs to agents who were in, for example, Siberian area, and then he would be unhappy if it starts to spread somewhere else. So and if it starts to spread to somewhere else, later we would try kind of to distinguish it, you know, to distinguish the fire, because it's kind of going on. Dr. Buteyko started to teach many doctors, again, Omsk, Tomsk, Krasnoyarsk regions, and there are many doctors, some leading doctors of different areas. But of course, it looks like they were probably like kind of delayed, or maybe we did not know exact methods, or like methods of control of like kind of other, you know, the groups, resources, like how we use like Patsys or Stooges and other organizations, again, apart from weft of letters and creating family problems, like problems with personal relationships for Dr. Buteyko in Siberia, again, as part of agents' work. They could do anything there because, again, like later, I believe, kind of this mechanism of control of and use of power of the hidden or secret phone call, for example, it became like a routine life for them. And no traces are left. See, like what I found also kind of interesting, and that's common for also really all Western world organizations and structures in relation to secret agents. We don't leave any traces. Let's say, like, when secret agents from KGB in 1968 stole 2 letters about this clinical approbation, clinical trial with amazing results, we did not provide any kind of letter or, like, you know, explaining, okay, if you are, like, director of the postal office, or we are going to withdraw, to take away from you these 2 letters and so on. And another kind of interesting thing, what I found extremely common for modern population, you know, if such agents would come to the postal office and would take such letters, you know what would the manager of this postal office going to think? What would create it in his head? He would think that was letters like related to terrorism. And secret agents came and they helped to save like thousands of lives. And on the West would be the same. Like in any Western countries, like let's say if secret agents would go to some postal office, or we would go to telephone company, say we need to like kind of intercept all your communication, like to connect in the middle, kind of be middle guy. Or we would go to any like all type of electronic communication would be the same story, because like we are created for control in a way. This is like to collect information, as we call. But of course, nobody specified like what for. So if nobody specified what for, then the result would be very, very simple. What for would be then for getting more power for themselves. So we know the Buteyko method, it's great, we would use it for themselves, of course. And then we would create, of course, problems so that other people would not be using it as Siberian doctors did it. As Siberian, KGB agents did it years ago. Now situation is looks like a bit different, as I told, because again some Siberian doctors resumed the teaching of the Buteyko method, which is great, but that's of course we are now very, very old already. Probably most of them already retired, because again, like what was, it was like 40 years ago, oh no, 30 plus years ago, the conference itself. So very long time ago, you can imagine like we are probably very, very old, or many would be retired. And now, so going back to kind of situation with current state of the Buteyko method, so I kind of went with historical excursus in different areas, different parts. I know my opinion would be also like related to another event which relates to creation of trademark on Buteyko method. That's kind of looks like totally weird method. Can you create a patent? Sorry, trademark on the method, because method is like for patents, you know, like we have like strong gradation of what is created for what. And I'm going to explain it in another video related to Buteyko trademarks and patents to explain, because I also believe, completely believe that actually that the Buteyko trademark, which is like totally, the whole idea is like, looks like really weird, strange, because you can't create, can you create like trademark on the name of the scientist? Because you see, like I'm going to analyze it later, you probably know, have you maybe heard about a chemical table of elements. So in Russia we call it Mendeleev's, because Mendeleev was a chemist who invented this table of, there is like similar kind of table, you know, with chemical elements. So it's called Mendeleev's table of chemical elements. So imagine you create a trademark Mendeleev and give it to relatives of Mendeleev. So that like anybody who want to write like instead of Buteyko Mendeleev here, table for example, would get to pay money, because it's trademark. So when you use a name, you have to pay money, like all these universities, schools, colleges, you know, and so on, where we use this result. Does it make sense like to give a trademark on the name of the scientist? So then the question, okay, it's a, like complete lunacy. It's like insane thing to give a trademark on the name of the scientist. Only one word, Buteyko. It's not like, let's say, hard to say, like if you create certain company, let's say Buteyko briefing devices, and then you can create a trademark for Buteyko briefing device for the whole thing, it could be kind of explained, because if you work on this company, if you pro Buteyko briefing, let's say briefing belts, because devices he did not like, Buteyko briefing belts, so would it be possible that somebody can get a trademark? Probably it's possible, because it has, when you use only Buteyko briefing belts altogether, then it would be something which you can probably get a trademark for. But when you have only word Buteyko, it means nobody can use this word in the, like say, if I am a practitioner or teacher of the method in Russia, I cannot use it unless I buy, I have to pay the owner of the trademark certain amount of money every year. So the question is, okay, who could create like this lunacy, you know, like, because then in somewhere in the world we can say, oh, there is like Isaac Newton, so let us give a trademark Newton, like to the relatives of, you know, famous physicist Isaac Newton. In physics in schools we say, oh, this is first Newton's law, this is second, third Newton's law. And we cannot tell it, because if its name is patented, you know, how you can tell about that? Or Einstein formula, you know, for example, of relativity. Give a trademark Einstein and so. So, but the question is, okay, who can create it? Well, again, you have to understand how the government organization works, how it works in real life. So in real life, it works really simple. Behind the back of people, secret agents go to these lawyers, makers of like patent bureaus, of trademark offices and so on, and we talk to them. We are very, very special people, you know, secret agents would say. We need this trademark, like, I don't know, maybe we feel better from having this trademark. And of course, you know, these lawyers, like people, bureaucrats, they would do anything, they would create, like, they would break, violate all type of rules, regulation, international practices, everything. And we would do whatever secret agents told them. So this is why trademark Buteyko exist in Russia. So it was done by KGB, Vladimir Putin friends. I don't know, maybe he was involved, hard to say, because this trademark is valid right now. And they use it themselves. So they kind of show one sign in Russia, like, you know, like they show this, like, in Russia, I don't know if you know what it means, to the people, to Russian people, in relation to health. And they use it for themselves now. This is KGB, modern secret, FSB, now we change the name, looks like, I don't know, name is changed, yeah, FSB, this is what they do in Russia. So that's the situation, or who killed Dr. Buteyko, and what is the situation right now?